Funding for Firing Line is provided by this station, by other public television stations, and by the following.
Over the years, we have given attention to the dispute concerning the assassination of President Kennedy in November of 1963. Primarily, we have relied on Mr. David Belin, a principal consultant and engineer of the Warren Report, who several years ago wrote a book reaffirming his belief that Lee Harvey Oswald acted alone on that awful afternoon. But now there is another book, another book by a responsible author. It is called The Plot to Kill the President. Its author, or rather co-author, is Professor Robert Blakey. And this book alleges that there were at least two figures doing the shooting in Dallas, and that reasonable men will conclude that the president was executed at the behest of the mob. Which, the theory goes on, President Kennedy had betrayed by refusing to acknowledge political and social favors. Professor Blakey was the chief counsel for the House Committee on Assassination set up in 1977. The committee did extensive research and issued its shocking findings on New Year's Day 1979. There was a minority report rejecting the findings of the majority, but these, reaffirmed by Professor Blakey in his book, rely heavily on a tape recording of a motorcycle which allegedly documents the existence of a fourth shot. That and a great deal of circumstantial evidence sustain Mr. Blakey's thesis. He is a professor of law at Notre Dame, who has also served as professor of law at Cornell. He has devoted most of the 20 years since graduating from law school to the study of organized crime in America. David Belin is a lawyer in Des Moines who graduated from the University of Michigan at its law school. In addition to the work he did on the Warren Commission, he served as executive director for the committee set up under Vice President Rockefeller to examine CIA activities within the United States in 1975. His own book on the assassination, published 10 years after the event, was called November 22nd, 1963, You Are the Jury. Our examiner today is Mr. Mark Green, well known to this audience, and himself an attorney, from whom more in due course. I'd like to begin by asking Mr. Blakey to tell us why his committee never called on David Belin to appear in a public session.
We had a general policy in the early stages of the investigation that all of our investigation took place in executive session. We ultimately had public hearings and called on all members of the Warren Commission that were alive, the executive director of the Warren Commission, and at least one of the attorneys. We had a limited schedule of hearings and frankly did not have time to work David in to the public hearings.
Well, you do understand, don't you, that at least at a perhaps superficial level, your failure to bring in the man most prominently identified as a defender of the Warren findings strikes people as avoiding a difficulty that might have gotten in the way of your hypothesis?
Well, we really, in the factual phase of the hearings, we were not in a debate, and most of the people that we called to testify had factual information. David was given an opportunity to appear in an executive session or by deposition. Frankly, what he would have been asked about would have been his own performance as a counsel, mm-hmm. and not necessarily to comment on the substantive questions. For example, we didn't call Mark Lane, who was certainly the most prominent critic of the Warren Commission. Nor did we call any of the other people who wrote books.
You didn't call Brezhnev either.
No, that's true. We were not trying to debate the issues mm-hmm. in a public forum. What we were trying to do is find the facts. Mm-hmm. And as we brought in people associated with the commission, it was to assess their performance. not necessarily to comment on their own work or
our
own work.
Well, would you acknowledge or would you not acknowledge, before we turn to Mr. Blakey, before we turn to Mr. Belin, would you acknowledge that there is such a thing as an expertise here defined very strictly as a body of operative knowledge?
Sure.
Concerning this, and would you acknowledge that Mr. Belin, by his continued interest in the controversy, as witness the publication 10 years after it, of a book that dealt rather copiously with all the critics,
but we read was so to speak a
carrier.
But Bill, we read his book, and I did not understand in the conversations that I had with him that he had all that much more to add to the controversy than his book.
That you had already transcended.
Well, you know, everybody has limited time and resources, as indeed the Warren Commission did, and you expend them in the most profitable way possible. And what we did not think it was profitable to do was to sift through the ashes of the old controversies.
You just told me that your committee published one more volume, to wit 27, than the Warren Commission did.
Well, that's a small piece of one-upmanship.
Mr. Belin, you make a considerable point, both in your correspondence on the work of Mr. Blakey, published in National Review and elsewhere, on what you consider to be a rather conspicuous snub of you and your special knowledge. Would you comment on what Mr. Blakey says and why you think it's relevant?
Well, I think that the expertise that I had, apart from my continuing interest in the whole area of the assassination of President Kennedy, was very unique because I served as executive director of the Rockefeller Commission investigating the CIA and was the one person in the world that not only had been intimately involved with the Warren Commission investigation, but had access to everything in the CIA pertaining to the assassination of President Kennedy.
Including its failure to cooperate with the committee?
Including its failure to cooperate with the committee, which was one of the principal reasons that I called for a reopening of the Warren Commission investigation in 1975 after my completion of service as executive director of the Rockefeller Commission, even though I said at the time that an objective reevaluation of all of the evidence would lead to the same conclusion that Lee Harvey Oswald was the lone gunman who killed President Kennedy and Officer J.D. Tippit. I was promised, in writing as well as orally, an opportunity to appear before that committee.
By whom?
By a number of members of that committee, one of whom was Congressman Richardson Pryor, who, by the way, at one time contacted me when the committee was having trouble obtaining a chief counsel to get my recommendations, and I hope you didn't recommend me. I told him that I did not think it was appropriate for me to engage in any recommendations, but at that time I did ask, and I was assured that I would have an opportunity to comment. Now, the concern I have is not just that I wasn't called, but there were other key people that were not called who, if I would have been an opportunity or had an opportunity to be there, I think that I would have had these congressmen who had to rely on their committee staff at least know that they were key witnesses who, for instance, would have led the committee to a different conclusion. I'll just briefly name two. One was Rabbi Hillel Silverman, who was the rabbi who visited Jack Ruby in his cell after Ruby shot Oswald and who probably was the person in the world who was most closely associated with the innermost thoughts of Ruby after Ruby killed Oswald, and I think Rabbi Silverman's comments would have been very perceptive in evaluating the theory of some of the staff that Ruby was conspiratorially involved, which, by the way, is Professor Blakey's theory.
And Judge Griffin.
Well, the members of the committee staff.
Yeah.
The other key person that wasn't called, and by the way, this person is also not mentioned in Professor Blakey's book, is a person by the name of Postal Inspector Holmes, who by happenstance decided not to go to church on the Sunday morning that Ruby shot Oswald. He went down to the police station to help his friend Captain Fritz interrogate Oswald. The transfer of Oswald, which should have taken place at 10, was delayed until around 11:30. Ruby never got downtown in Dallas until around 11:15 or so, and if Postal Inspector Holmes would have just gone to church that morning, Ruby would not have had an opportunity to kill Oswald. Now, why Holmes was not contacted to testify about that, why he's not included in Professor Blakey's book.
Yeah, but David, you know, that information was available in the Warren Commission's reports, published. We had access to it. And I go back to 2 points. One is we can quarrel as lawyers or as an interrogator over the procedures that we followed and suggest that it could have been fuller, more ample, we'd had more time and more money. And that's an appropriate procedural critique to make of what we did. But I think we really ought to talk about the substance, which is what happened
yes.
to John Kennedy.
Yeah, I'm coming to that. I just wanted to
we could have done it ineptly and arrived at the truth. We could have done it with all the skill and competency in the world and arrived at a falsehood.
So the question before the House is there a relationship between your conclusions, which Mr. Belin judges to be false, and the alleged ineptitude of your approach, which led you to those conclusions. So let's state the conclusions for the benefit of the audience who may not be familiar
with them. We can discuss both, but I think that most people would rather worry about what happened to John Kennedy than procedural details of a congressional committee.
That's right.
I can talk about procedural details of the Warren Commission or procedural details of the Rockefeller Commission, and that might be interested to a student of the Congress or government agencies.
Well, only insofar as they are relevant to its conclusions. We don't talk about the exclusionary rule or other defects.
That's my problem with it. My concern is what happened to John Kennedy.
Yeah.
And if we had stumbled into it by luck and found the truth, then it seems to me as the truth is what we ought to address.
Yeah. Well, why don't you, if you'd be so kind, give us in slightly greater detail than I was able to during the introduction, your fix, your final fix on what did happen to John Kennedy.
Let me put it in context for you, Bill. David remembers that the committee that I worked for had a great deal of difficulty in an early stage with a different chief counsel and a different chairman, and I was asked to come down and help out. I did so with great misgivings, principally because I had known some of the people who worked for the Warren Commission, and I knew them to be very able people. Howard Willens, one of the principal deputies, was a good friend of mine. I did not think a conspiracy had occurred, and least of all that the mob would have been involved. My own expertise, as you put it earlier, for some 20 years, told me that this was not their kind of operation. Mm-hmm. I went down principally in a hope that I could do what I could to restore some dignity to the process. And I got down there, and we began to look into all
this
of the
after the mess involving your predecessor.
Yeah, yeah. And David came by to talk to me. We had a nice conversation. He gave me a copy of his book, and I read it very thoroughly. And then we began to get into the critical literature on the Warren Commission, most of which does not withstand careful analysis. It is trash. We got into what the Warren Commission had done and found that, on the whole, the people were very able, very competent, and that the general lack of support that they have in the community, and it's like 80% now no longer believe the Warren Commission conclusions, is undeserved. Our disagreements with the commission ultimately is based on supplementary evidence. It's not something that they did or failed to do or failed to analyze. What they did well. It's what they didn't have access to.
In other words, if you had been running the Warren Commission, you would
probably
have come to identical findings.
Yes, on the evidence available to them. Yeah. For example, they did not know about the CIA mafia plots, that our own agency was plotting with the mob to kill Castro. That bore on the possibility of a Castro retaliation theory. I think that they would have conducted a more thorough investigation in that area. I don't know that they would have come up with a different conclusion, but this is at least what some of their staff people told us. They didn't have access to the great wealth of information that we did about organized crime, principally the conversations of the mob figures themselves discussing John Kennedy, the hate that they had for him and his brother Robert, actually discussing their death. In the context of the Kennedy administration's program against organized crime, that bore heavily on the motive. I think if the commission had known that, and they did not, that they might have conducted a different kind of investigation and gone further. On the key question, though, that is what happened to John Kennedy in the plaza, and I think that's ultimately where the argument must begin, although not end, is while they had the tape of the recording of the police officer, they did not subject it to the kind of sophisticated acoustical and statistical analysis that we did.
Tell them what that tape did.
Okay. According to our investigation, there was a police officer whose name was H.B. McLean, whose microphone button was accidentally depressed, ironically during the actual period of the assassination.
He was on another channel, wasn't he?
He was on channel one.
Yeah.
There are two channels, channel one and channel two. He broadcast the sounds of the assassination back to the dispatcher's tape, which is actually a dictabelt, and it was recorded. Now, what the Warren Commission did is they took the dictabelt from channel one and channel two and typed up the transcripts because they wanted to know what the officers were saying to each other during the time.
And tried to make it correspond to the Zapruder film.
To that degree.
Yeah.
They did not subject that tape to sophisticated acoustical analysis, although they looked for, principally from the media, possible tapes with the hope of doing what we did. Well, when we got the tape, it was alleged by some critics that that tape had been, that channel had been blocked for that 7 minutes as part of the conspiracy. We recognized that if it had been blocked, it might have recorded the sounds of the assassination from the plaza, and so we sent the tape up to Bolt, Brannick, and Newman, which is a very, very able acoustical firm. It was recommended to us by the Acoustical Society of America. They're the ones who did the Watergate tapes for Judge Sirica. They're also the ones that did the...
You mean the 18-and-a-half-minute business?
Yes.
Because, as you know, there's a lot of...
Controversy over that. They also did the analysis of the tapes at Kent State to establish which officer shot first in which order. Bolt, Brannick, and Newman looked at it, and they said, there's nothing in this. We don't think we can do anything for you. And my response was, well, Jim, that's fine, but what I want you to do is prove to me that there's nothing in it. I can't just take your word for it. Mm-hmm. My critics are going to be all over me on this. So he set out with the scientific hypothesis that there was nothing on the tape. Mm-hmm. He subsequently called me and said, Bob, I can't establish that there's nothing on the tape. In fact, I have found impulses on this that have the pattern of gunfire. And I said, fine. What order? What direction? What timing? And he says, well, I've got the three that the Warren Commission indicated, but I've also got another one from the Grassy Knoll.
7/10 of a second earlier.
7/10. There are three shots in sequence. One from the depository, a second one from the depository, a third one from the Grassy Knoll, a fourth one from the depository. And the difference between the third and the fourth in sequence is 7/10 of a second. Mm-hmm. The kind of equipment being used is obviously not high fidelity equipment. You cannot make a perfect analysis of it. Mm-hmm. What we did is we went back down to Dallas and reconstructed the sounds of the assassination for an experimental tape. And then we matched over our 1978 tape to the 1963 tape to see what kind of correspondence we could get. Mm-hmm. In other words, we fired guns in Dealey Plaza to get a test, a benchmark, and then saw if we could match it. And after the process was over, their testimony to us was using sophisticated statistical analyses as opposed to acoustical analyses, that there was a 95% plus probability.
That's where they went from 50 to 95.
That's right. It was a refinement of the test. What we then did is go back into the oral and eyewitness testimony in the plaza to see if this thing stood alone. And what you find is that there were approximately 250 people in the plaza, 171 of which were interviewed. A majority didn't know where the shots came from. About 49 said they came from the depository. Some 21 said they came from the Grassy Knoll, including people like Bill and Gail Newman, who were standing on the grassy area. Grassy Knoll is like this, and there's a fence here, and the president is coming down here. Bill and Gail Newman are standing here, and they say the shot came in directly over their head, and they dropped to the ground. Incidentally, we did not call them in our public hearings. We didn't have time. Very relevant witnesses, but we didn't call them. There's a man, S.M. Holland, who's standing on a railroad pass down here, and who, in retrospect, gives us the exact sequence, four shots, directions, and even saw smoke appear on the fence area. He's also a man who ran behind the fence and found footprints in the mud. They had been raining earlier that day, right behind the place where the shot had come from. Mm-hmm. So that there is substantial eyewitness and ear witness testimony that corroborates the tape itself.
Well, I know the importance you attach to that particular point, because you wrote an addendum to your Sir rebuttal to David Belin a year or so ago, in which you said that the Justice Department's own experts were evaluating the authenticity of the of this replication, of this authentication. And I would now like to ask Mr. Belin if he would be so kind as to comment on this point, which all parties seem to be agreed on as crucial.
Crucial, but not solely crucial.
Although, no, well, we'll
what
get
it
to that,
provides
sure.
is
not just positive.
What it provides you is physical corroboration for the testimony that the Warren Commission had in 63 and rejected because it didn't have physical corroboration.
Yeah.
It's a very important point to make.
I would disagree in a number of ways. First of all, it, so far as the committee was concerned, was the crucial element. The committee, up until the last 3 weeks of its investigation, had the acoustical tests. And by the way, you can't hear anything on this tape. You hear static. All of these conclusions of the so-called experts are made from putting waves on some kind of a scope that you see on a screen.
And making interpretations because you don't understand it, do you?
My point is that you cannot hear shots. The tape itself, the officer claims that he did not have his microphone on so-called channel one, that his microphone was on channel two, where all the microphones of all the vehicles in the motorcade was on. On this so-called channel, you hear the sounds of a chime, and there were no chimes in Dealey Plaza, that it appears from statements made by the people involved who were not called back by the House Assassination Committee, that the stuck microphone was on that of another motorcycle miles away. The motorcycle policeman McLean claims that right after the shots, the motorcade in general, and he in particular, took off racing toward Parkland
Hospital. The films, incidentally, don't support him on that.
But the film certainly showed that the motorcade took off.
But
sirens,
not, but
you know,
not,
you're
going
to have
McLean.
Professor Blakey, you're going to have to let me finish here. You know, you didn't let me have a chance to testify in Washington, and I at least ought to have an opportunity to speak here. There are no sounds of sirens of the motorcade going toward the hospital. There are no sounds of the motorcycles revving up as they sped off. One of the members of the committee, himself, incredulous, of the interpretations of the staff, described these interpretations as being made because the staff wanted to reach a conclusion of conspiracy. Now, what you had up to the last 3 weeks was all of this massive evidence which showed that all of the shots came from Oswald's rifle, the cartridge cases were in the window where Oswald fired them, the bullets that struck President Kennedy and Governor Connally ballistically came from Oswald's rifle. The only place people saw a gunman with a rifle at the time the shots were fired were in the window where that gunman fired. You have Oswald being the murderer of not only Kennedy but Tippit. You take all of this massive evidence and all of a sudden you say, but on the other hand, here is a group of experts which say there is a 50% chance of a possibility.
95%, David.
The first reading was 50%.
Sure, a preliminary reading.
Professor Blakey, you have to let me finish now, please. The first reading was 50%, and there is a secret report that has never been released, a preliminary draft of the final report. I've seen it.
He says that was hypothetical.
It's more than hypothetical.
It's a contingency draft, David, written by the staff, never reviewed by the committee.
There was
no significance.
Professor Blakey, you really have to let me finish now.
Yeah, no, wait a minute. But
not filibuster.
But you have to acknowledge this, that it is perfectly all right, isn't it, for an investigating committee to say, prepare me a report that bounces off this being authentic, prepare me another report that bounces off it's not being authentic.
They didn't prepare the second report. They prepared just the first in the face of a so-called 50% possibility.
David, why don't you let me testify about our own internal processes rather than make inferences from the outside?
If you want to reply, that's fine, but let me just finish what I'm saying. It's going to give me a take out about another minute.
Okay.
We'll come right back to you.
The 50% possibility theory was thrown out because the House committee said in the face of all of this other overwhelming evidence, there was no second gunman. Then at the very last minute, they come up with this 95% testimony, and the majority of the committee switches. Professor Blakey writes to the National Review and says that the FBI, Department of Justice, are going to conduct tests. If these tests don't show that there is a 95% possibility,
I didn't say that.
Well, I have the letter.
He says, word for word.
He says, basically,
it will be done with competency and integrity. If so, I will abide by its results. If it indicates that there is not a 95% probability that there was a gunshot from the grassy knoll, I will write a letter to the review and withdraw all that I have said.
Absolutely, word for word.
Yeah.
Basically, the FBI came out and said, the committee is just wrong. I'm not here to say that the FBI is absolutely right, but what I am here to say is that in this situation, as in so many others, the testimony of scientific experts differ. And if the committee at one time on the basis of a 50% probability said, and without the FBI, said there is no second gunman, now they have experts that say there is a 95% in the last couple of weeks, and now the FBI says it's a 0%, you're faced with the disagreement of experts, and I would have to conclude that reasonable minds would say we have to really say this is not the situation of identifying what an elephant looks like when you're blind by touching his trunk. You have to take a look at the overall mass of the evidence, and the mass of the evidence is, and I believe I could have convinced the committee majority if I would have had an opportunity to testify that there was no second gunman.
Yes. Okay. Most of what you said is untrue, and if somebody will bother to read the book or our exchange of correspondence in the National Review, it's a point-by-point answer. Let me not take up all of our time here by going point-by-point, but to treat the major issues. First of all, the committee never voted prior to the last night as to what they thought. There were numerous discussions going on back and forth. We had the basic evidence from the acoustics in July. The senior people who understood it knew where it might come out, and it might very easily come out that we had two shooters and we'd have to live with it. From that point in July forward, there was contingency planning. If this stuff stays and holds in there, we are probably going to have to analyze it in this way. If this stuff does not stay and does not hold in there, we're probably going to have to analyze it in this way. The report to which you refer was a contingency drafted totally by the staff. It was never looked at by any members of the committee and was rejected, frankly, by the committee when they finally got it. The judgment...
Rejected because the acoustical report had come in...
More so than that. Our judgment that there was a conspiracy...
It was intrinsically insufficient.
We explicitly said in the final report that our judgment was made that there was a conspiracy because of several factors. One, the inadequacy of the Warren Commission's investigation that would have precluded a conspiracy. Second is the fact that we identified people who had the motive, opportunity, and means to kill the president and had associations that had not been developed by the Warren Commission. And what we felt was the coherency of the scenario of the assassination itself, which was an integration of all of the hard physical evidence, the film, the tape, the ballistics, the eyewitness and ear witness testimony. Consequently, when the final judgment came down, they voted their consciences based on what they knew from the beginning. Now, as for the FBI, the FBI's conclusion did not say that what we did was a zero percentage, David. What they did is they simply restated our finding. Our finding was a statistical probability of 95%. What they said is 95% subtracted from 100 equals 5%. Mm-hmm. There's a 5% chance of wrong, being wrong. And
they said even by your own reasoning.
By our own reasoning. Yeah. And what they then said, since we did not prove identity, we did not prove the point. Well, this is a straw man. We never undertook to prove identity. We undertook to prove 95%. Another way of saying that is a 5% chance of error. The final conclusion was made by the committee not on the 95% probability, which in the end the FBI does not dispute. There is a 95% probability. All they pointed out was that if you take that 95% probability and apply it to another random set of instances, you'll get a counterexample, which is inconsistent with your example. That's another way of stating what we stated. In fact, it is really rather disappointing that the FBI did not do independent tests and did not recognize the statistical nature of what we did. I said that I would withdraw my statement, and I really mean that. My mind is not closed on these issues. If you bring me more evidence, I'll change it.
Okay, let me ask you a more philosophical question, if I may. You mentioned a moment ago that here you had a situation in which you could prove that there were people with motive, opportunity, and means for killing the president. At the other end, you have a dead president, so somebody killed him. Now, what's to keep me or anybody else with $1 million in the subpoena power to coming up with all kinds of people who have motive, opportunity, and means to kill the president and to come to the conclusion that someone other than Lee Harvey Oswald was also involved?
Bill, nothing, and everybody has.
That's right. Yes, you reject the CIA as the killer, you reject the FBI as the killer.
Let me comment on that in two ways. One is that statistically the police today discover the identity of the killers in most homicides, 85-90% of the time. And the reason they do is that most homicides grow out of sex or alcohol. And after you've ticked off the spouses and the girlfriends or the boyfriends, you've identified the probable suspects, find out which ones have alibi, and you've got your guy. The problem with the President of the United States is, while we may love him, he has an enormous number of enemies. Kennedy was hated by Khrushchev. Kennedy was hated by Castro. Kennedy was hated by the mob. He was hated by the South Vietnamese. All those people, he was hated by people in the CIA and the FBI.
He was hated by lots of people in Dallas.
That's true as well. He was hated by the oil millionaires. So you can develop a large list of suspects. Mm-hmm. The difference between developing the suspects on a motive, opportunity, and means analysis and saying that they did it is the absence of that connective evidence at the end. You got to connect them to it as well as show that they had the motive, opportunity, and means.
Yes, but you spend a considerable part of your book in saying that this is the kind of thing the mob does, provided certain lines are crossed.
Well, one of the things you have to...
But all of that analysis is useless in regard to Lee Harvey Oswald, and we know that he fired the fatal bullet.
Well, we also know that he was killed by Jack Ruby within 48 hours.
Yeah, but we also...
And the question then arises is one of two things. Either that assassination is connected to the prior assassination or it's not.
Mm-hmm.
If it is, it shapes, colors, and determines the previous one. The common sense interpretation of Jack Ruby's assassination of Oswald is he did it to silence him. One of the remarkable things, and I must say, David, I was allowed myself to be convinced in 63 that the common sense was not correct, that Jack Ruby was a sort of unguided missile. When we went back and looked into his background, character, and associations, carefully explored what we thought were his motivations, carefully explored his trial, we came to the conclusion that he stalked Lee Harvey Oswald for 48 hours.
Well, you said that he was not insane. He wasn't interested enough even to attend the parade.
He was not enough to attend the parade, and that far from being a inept operator of a shady nightclub, a sleazy nightclub in Dallas, in fact, that he had grown up with the mob in the south side of Chicago, had worked in organized crime operations in Chicago. He was a runner for Al Capone when he was a young man. The strip joint that he operated in Dallas was on a circuit that had strip girls coming from throughout the country. He got his girls immediately from the Marcello's bar in New Orleans. He was a courier in and out of Cuba, probably for Santos Traficante. In other words, the benign picture painted by the Warren Commission does not withstand close analysis.
Of somebody whose indignation just simply mounted.
Overwhelming.
Okay, now Mr. Belin, do you consider this aspect, this i.e., this sort of character analysis of this man as relevant in any way to your findings? And did you then consider it when you were working for the Warren Commission?
Yes, as a matter of fact, from a preliminary standpoint, when I first came to Washington to work with the Warren Commission, I surmised that it was very possible, perhaps probable, that Jack Ruby killed Oswald to silence him. I finally reached the other conclusion because there was no direct ties that could be proven, number one, because Jack Ruby volunteered and insisted against the advice of his own attorneys that he take a lie detector test, a polygraph exam, and although it isn't determinative...
But even the FBI said that's an invalid test, and they asked the Warren Commission not to look at it, David.
Professor Blakey, you're really going to have...
They said don't consider it.
You know, you're going to have to let me finish now. I've been patiently listening to your discussion. I think I ought to have an opportunity that you didn't give me in Washington before the House Assassination Committee to respond. The very fact that Ruby wanted to have the polygraph examination taken is certainly, from a common sense standpoint, indicative of the fact that he is not conspiratorially involved, because people that are conspiratorially involved don't necessarily insist upon taking a lie detector test against the advice of their attorneys.
Indeed, some people like Alger Hiss continue to refuse to do so.
Right. Mm-hmm. And now, I don't say it's admissible in a court of law. I do know that it is valid in the hands of an experienced operator.
Which it was not done in this case.
Professor
conceded
Blakey,
by the FBI, conceded
don't
by Hoover.
Don't say, let him, just say it.
Just do it.
Okay. Basically, the fact that Ruby himself, by happenstance, had the opportunity to kill Oswald. If he were stalking Oswald, he wouldn't have waited to come down in Dallas on 11 o'clock or 11:15 on Sunday morning. We know when he got down there because there was a stamp on the postal money order that he sent to one of his employees. He would have come down before 10 because Oswald was going to be transferred around 10 o'clock. If he wanted to stalk and kill Oswald, He also would have had an opportunity to do that at other times than the so-called transfer point. But the most conclusive evidence to me is a combination of happenstance of Postal Inspector Holmes delaying the transfer of Oswald, and the other thing that Rabbi Silverman, a person who Professor Blakey didn't call in the $6 million investigation, is absolutely convinced, based upon his intimate conversations with Jack Ruby in the Dallas cell, that Ruby was not conspiratorially involved.
Now, well, Professor Blakey works in a Catholic community in which it is assumed that confessional relationships are not subpoenable. Don't you accept that as an explanation?
I accept that as an explanation to the extent that the person who was involved, if Jack Ruby were living, he could say to Rabbi Silverman, I don't want you to testify. He has to raise the privilege. And now that Jack Ruby
is... You're not permitted to testify unless the person waives it, and if the person is dead,
he can't waive it.
The person is dead. I don't know of any case, maybe, you know, Professor Blakey's a professor. I don't know of any case where a dead person can say that I hereby invoke the privilege. I do know
what they say is you cannot speak unless the person waives it. But look, this is the procedure.
The Rabbi Silverman is absolutely convinced, and he would have been willing to testify whether there was or wasn't a privilege.
Well, but Rabbi Silverman has presumably since been heard from. If he didn't consider that this was privileged, what Ruby said to him was privileged, then he would have gone ahead and testified what in fact he did say, right?
That's right.
Well, he did. And in fact, it appears in the Warren Commission volumes. He says, based on my conversations with him, I don't think he did it, which is interesting. It's an opinion evidence of a person who talked to him, but it's hardly determinative of the issue. Let me make another point,
but
Bill.
The House committee never called Rabbi Silverman with all of the $6 million.
The third time you've made that. Showing coincidence in the actual occurrence hardly indicates the lack of conspiracy. Always, in every football game, there is coincidence in how it's finally won. And that doesn't mean there wasn't a game plan. For example, that Lee Harvey Oswald was able to find the Texas School Book Depository job that put him in the position to shoot at the president by your investigation and ours is happenstance. Yet, hundreds of people believe that that happenstance was an indication of planning and conspiracy finding the job. What I'm suggesting to you is that simply because he finally reached him, this is what the Holmes testimony goes to, by happenstance, doesn't mean that in the period of 48 hours he didn't try to get to him at least 4 to 5 times. And I don't think that undermines conspiracy. What I'm suggesting to you, in short, is that conspiracy is consistent with happenstance in its execution.
Yeah, he tried to kill General Walker and failed.
Yeah.
Which was happenstance.
That he failed was happenstance. That's
by
correct.
He, you mean Oswald.
Yeah. Oswald, yes.
Now, let me ask you this before we turn to the examiner. Why, you say 80% of the American people don't believe the Warren Commission findings.
That's what the polls indicate.
Yeah, A, why is that so? And B, if that is so, why don't they show a normal man's intellectual curiosity and read your book with greater attention and with a more open mind?
Let me answer it in two ways. One is that David was the counsel for President Ford when he appeared before us. So in a sense, it's not fair to say that David didn't appear before us, because he certainly was able to write the answers to many of the things that President Ford said to us. And one of the things I agree with, and the reason I cite it, President Ford was asked why the Warren Commission is held in such disrepute. And he suggested a lot of people are cynical, and he suggested as a lot of people haven't read the report. And I think that accounts for a great deal.
That plus the CIA, leaving out the CIA factor?
That accounts for a great deal of what I think is the unjustified reputation of the Warren Commission. On my own book, I'm afraid that there is a kind of Gresham's law of literature, that the bad drives out the good, and that so many intelligent, articulate people who would be interested in this have been turned off by the irresponsible books that have been written, that to get through that initial resistance.
You mean if Mark Lane at all hadn't written, this would have been taken more seriously?
If Mark Lane had not written, and I can go down a long list of what I consider to be, and I'm sure David and I are in agreement on this, really trashy essays.
Yeah.
That it is difficult for a book that is written in a cerebral way, that does not necessarily invoke people's liberal or anti-governmental biases to be heard. Mm-hmm. And that if there is a difficulty with the book, I think it's those two things.
I would like to say something nice about Professor Blakey. I really am upset that he never called me when he called so many others. But one thing I have to say kindly about him and his investigation, that there was a lot of what they did that was very well done, and particularly their analysis of the medical testimony and the medical evidence, which proved that all of the shots that struck President Kennedy came from behind, that the shot that struck Governor Connally came from behind, and that
notwithstanding Connally's insistence on the opposite.
Right.
Oh, no, no. We finally established Connally was correct, and the Warren Commission's rejection of him was wrong.
Oh, on the rebound thing.
No, this is very interesting, and David really has to blow hot or cold. Either we did good work or we did bad work.
No, I don't.
Sometimes a football team wins, and sometimes they
fumble in the process.
But let me finish.
Just on the Connally point.
It is on the scientific material. We reestablished, in fact, established better in some cases than they did, because we had more science and technology available to us, that their basic scenario was correct. And again, that the critics were wrong on it. For example, the single bullet theory is absolutely correct. We established it with the photographs and with the ballistics testimony and the neutron activation analysis testimony.
Yeah, but Connally rejected that also.
Yeah, but he's wrong on that. Mm-hmm. Yeah, his memory is just not as good as the science.
So you two agree on that?
Absolutely.
But you disagree with what? You say that Connally was sustained on which point?
The first bullet misses everybody.
Yeah.
The second bullet hits both Kennedy and Connally. Right. Several frames in the Zapruder film earlier than what you people looked at. And when you look at 157, where we looked, you can see Connally turning around, as he always testified, and a little girl freezing in the back frame. And then when you look a little further to about 187, Kennedy and Connally are perfect in alignment in the film. This is where the acoustic says it occurred, and that's the point at which the bullet goes through both of them. And the neutron activation analysis establishes that the bullet fragments in Connally's wrist are from the bullet fired from Oswald's rifle, the so-called CE-399. The irony of it is much of our scientific work confirmed, and I think put beyond reasonable doubt, things like the single bullet thesis that had been the underpinning of the critics' analysis before.
I see. Okay, well, let's turn to Mr. Mark Green. Mr. Green is often associated with Ralph Nader, for whom he worked for 10 years, during which he wrote 7 or 8 books and ran the congressional lobby called Congress Watch. He is now an author and a lawyer and a lecturer living in Manhattan, who's also founded a research institute called the Democracy Project. Mr. Green.
Within the last 24 hours, I've asked 7 friends if they thought Oswald was the lone assassin, whether there was a conspiracy. 6 said conspiracy. So based on my scientific experimentation, Professor Blakey's onto something. Your book is persuasive, taken alone. The problem is so many of these books, taken alone, without contrary evidence, are persuasive, hence Mark Lane's popularity. But let me ask you just a couple of common sense questions based on your theory. Is it possible 18 years later that there is no direct evidence of organized crime's involvement, given how many thousands of interceptions there are of organized crime, given how many periodic Velacis come forward to spill on fellow members? And second, is it possible, with so many hundreds of people congregating in the plaza that day, that no one saw a person within shooting distance of the president, watching the president, to come forward and testify?
Well, let me answer the second question first. J.M. Smith, an officer, who was down at the corner, in fact ran behind the fence, and was met by a person who had apparently false Secret Service credentials and allowed to go by. So I think there is a sense in which the second gunman was seen. He certainly, the evidence of him was seen, the footprints in the ground, the smoke, and what happened. But let me go back to the first question. Mm-hmm. Is it possible that the nature of this conspiracy, if it was organized crime-based, would not have been uncovered? The answer is yes. The electronic surveillance that we looked into, which incidentally I thought would prove they didn't do it, was not comprehensive. It did not cover Dallas, it did not cover New Orleans, it did not cover Tampa.
The electronic surveillance
of the organized crime leaders.
Oh, yeah, right. Mm-hmm.
So that the Marcello family, the Savella family, the Trafficante family have not been subjected to electronic surveillance in these years. Another aspect of that is that While Valachi has come forward and told about the mob itself, this conspiracy, to be reasonable, would have been very small in number. And second is, just as Oswald was killed even in a police station within 48 hours, our friend behind the grassy knoll probably has cement shoes and he's in the midst of Lake Pontchartrain. It's very doubtful that they would have left those kinds of witnesses in existence.
In your book, you say that, you state flatly in the beginning of one of the later chapters, that organized crime had a hand in the killing of John Kennedy. On the book jacket, it says, organized crime flat out assassinated JFK. Mm-hmm. And in your promotional literature that your publisher, not you, put out, it says you have proof that organized crime killed John Kennedy. By the way, do you think you have proof, or is that just the difference between a careful author and a sensationalizing publisher?
Mark, what the book does that I think the promotion does not is it makes a distinction in the degree of confidence by which we know things. We know conspiracy, I think, to a scientific certitude.
Certitude?
I don't think reasonable people should disagree, even though David is a reasonable person. And that in time, I think that will be vindicated.
Let
me finish.
Then do I get a chance to speak?
Sure. Okay. Is on the question of the mob's involvement, what the book says as opposed to the literature, which I hope no author should be held responsible for what his publisher says, is that is the single best scenario today. And if more evidence comes in that pushes in another direction, I certainly would accept it.
By the way, did you see what the publisher wrote before they released it?
Yeah.
So you
but I was not really free to change it.
So many of us are not.
I would like to comment the
yeah,
whole...
That's sort of conventional, isn't it?
The whole concept of...
I couldn't even name the title of the book.
The whole concept of footprints that could have been made by any one of 1,000 different people occurring behind a fence and saying, aha, this is where a gunman is. The supposed gunman was barely 100 feet away. He fires a rifle that no one sees, leaves no cartridge cases, leaves no bullets, not only misses his target, but misses a presidential limousine of close to 20 feet long, moving at 11 miles an hour.
Leaves no bullet at the other end.
Nothing. You've seen nothing. It just confounds common sense and logic. Now, what you have to have, it seems to me, if you're going to prove conspiracy, as I understand the standard of proof, it's beyond a reasonable doubt.
In a criminal case, but this is not a criminal case. This is a question of history. And it's a question, therefore, of probabilities.
If it were a criminal case, you'd have some defendants.
That's right.
And even if you have it by the so-called preponderance of the evidence, the fact is that a person sees smoke in days of basically smokeless gun. The person that said he saw smoke...
Even the FBI said that Oswald's gun makes smoke.
Signed an affidavit saying, my head is spinning. The Warren Commission interviewed Holland. One of my colleagues did. This isn't someone that the House Assassination Committee dug up. The greater weight of the evidence is that there was no conspirator except for this one disagreement on the burden of proof on the tapes. And by the way, the FBI comes and flat out, so far as the tapes are concerned, and I have the report here, it says basically the House Select Committee on Assassination's finding that scientific acoustical evidence establishes a high probability that two gunmen fired at John F. Kennedy is invalid. That's what the FBI says.
And then look at the nature of the reasoning.
Let me interrupt both of you this time so you can both yell at me. Your book very carefully, and I think ably, exposes how the extent to which the CIA plotted to kill Castro, apparently without telling the president or the director of the CIA, how they came close to torturing a Soviet double or perhaps triple agent, Nisenko, how the FBI destroyed a note that Oswald sent the FBI before the assassination, how Alan Dulles said, before your group, I guess, that he would lie under oath to protect certain CIA secrets. You then write, let me quote, to adopt Soviet methods in an effort to defeat the Soviets was in our judgment to become like the Soviets, to avoid letting them win, a course of action that constituted not the path of victory, but surrender to the Soviet way of life. Let me ask Mr. Buckley if he agrees with that critique of Professor Blakey's
absolutely
of the intelligence agencies.
And why not? Absolutely not.
You're in favor of torture?
And your critique of, attack on the CIA and FBI.
I'm going to answer the general question and then let the specific questions come later. If you say to me, am I in favor of torture, my answer is no. If you say to me, is torture the worst possible thing, I'd say no, there are things that are worse. For instance, the Third World War is worse.
Sure.
Now, in answer to your question, the cliche that by imitating the methods of the Soviet Union, we become like the Soviet Union is exactly that, a cliche ungrounded in experience. We both engage in secret work. We both engaged in efforts at intelligence penetration. We both engaged to a certain extent in disinformation. The difference always is between the motives of the contending parties, not with their methods.
But specifically,
but there is
did
a
you,
level of
did
too.
You, would there you disagree with
yes. There is obviously a much greater presumptive reluctance by free societies to do certain things.
We normally don't torture
that's
people,
right, that's
even
right.
our enemies.
That's exactly correct. And when Jack Kennedy lied to the American people by saying that he had a cold, therefore he wanted to come back to the White House, and it wasn't a cold at all, it was a matter of discovering that there were intermediate Soviet missiles
in Cuba. But
nobody
really considers that, that a lie.
Well, that's disinformation, it's lying.
No,
and I'm saying there's
not.
A greater presumption against that in America than there is in the Soviet
speech,
Union.
But it's not a lie.
But the issue is not whether he had a cold,
a
but should we kill Castro? You're not saying that the CIA should have entertained the thought of killing Fidel Castro in the early 60s?
No, I'm simply talking about your generality. If you want me to apply this to a tactical level,
yes.
I would say that it would depend on any number of circumstances. We killed a Japanese admiral and decorated the man who did so during the Second World War. Question is, were our relationships towards a man who had just a few months before imported missiles, which would have taken out half of mid-America, do we have a legitimate bellicose relationship towards him, or do we have a different kind of relationship? All these are complicated questions. And I'll remind you of my favorite book on the subject, which is The Day of the Jackal, in which, by means of torture, the French security discover the man who was about to kill de Gaulle. And these people are popular heroes in America, these people who resorted to these means. This is not a justification. It simply draws you back to the weakness of the generality you attempted to impose on us.
Yeah, I don't think so, actually. So I don't think it's that complicated. To kill an adversary with whom the Japanese, under a declaration of war, is exponentially different than killing someone with whom you have hostile relationships. We probably have several dozen countries in the world
who
we don't like, but we don't kill their leadership.
The operative distinction in your phrase is the declaration of war. Now, if you want to give that a sacramental quality, because it is a civic gesture of some antecedent interest, you are free to do so. But there are many of us who believe, for instance, that the war we conducted against Vietnam or against North Korea, even though it was not declared such, was just as deadly as any war we've ever participated in.
Of course, since Brezhnev is more threatening than Castro, your analysis would lead to killing Brezhnev, even though there's no declaration of war.
As
I do
the moderator,
consider it an operative
I interrupt
fact.
And suggest
sure.
that we come back to the subject
sure,
matter, which
course.
Is what happened to President Kennedy.
You think the trail is so cold that we'll never know? So many of the principles are
now dead. It depends on
what
you mean by no, Mark. In fact, one of the reasons it is a cliche that hindsight's better than foresight is that with hindsight we know more. The reason it's a cliche is it's true. We now know a lot more about what happened to the president than we did then.
David, I would like to comment.
Well, let me finish, David.
Well, pardon me, I thought you were finished.
Yeah, I thought there was a cadence there at the end of that sentence.
I think that we now know about the CIA mafia plots. We now know about the more acoustical evidence. I think that the burden of history will not settle this for those people who have biases and prejudgments. But I think it will emerge over time that the president
apparently settled it for 6 out of 7 of his friends, so that doesn't tell us much about the national course
Well,
section.
It would depend on
tell you about my friends.
Who his friends are.
It just tells us that the majority is not always right. I would add...
Well, it's also something that argues against res judicata. I mean, a book was published the day before yesterday that said that the Supreme Court of the United States had no right to declare a law unconstitutional. And the day after tomorrow, somebody will write and say that Brutus didn't kill Julius Caesar and so on. But there is a kind of a reluctance to accept any givens in our society, which is a cultural point.
Right. There is also, in our society generally, the people that have attempted to kill presidents have been lone people, even the persons that attempted to kill President Ford, the person that attempted to kill President Reagan. As a matter of fact, in October of 1980, I was on a plane with Senator Baker and suggested to him that one of the concerns I had was that within the first 12 months of President Reagan's office, some lone person, would try and take a shot at him. I happen to have a concern that this might happen again in the next 4 years just because of the fact that we live in a society where out of 200 and some million people, some crazy person, like a Lee Harvey Oswald or like a John Hinckley, or if John was his first name, whatever his first name was, are going to take a pot shot. some people are going to conclude that that person did it as a part of conspiracy. What's happened here is that people have taken a segment of the evidence. They have refused to go into the mass of evidence, which really conclusively shows that Oswald was the lone gunman. And unfortunately, in this situation, what has happened is that the one body of scientific opinion with which other scientific groups disagree says that they think that their interpretations of an acoustical tape shows a 95% probability of a forced shot, ipso facto conspiracy, when a conspiracy really didn't take place.
Mr. Belin, let me ask you a question to try to get more truth and scoring points between the two of you. Given Professor Blakey's book and the substantial investigation that the committee undertook, do you now regret anything that the Warren Commission either did or omitted to do in its investigation?
Well, he's on public record on that.
Yes. I regretted at the time, almost resigned from the Warren Commission at the time, the fact that the Warren Commission didn't have an opportunity to have the photographs and x-rays of President Kennedy out of deference to President Kennedy's family. I was appalled when I served with the Rockefeller Commission to find that the CIA had withheld evidence from the Warren Commission.
And demanded the reconstitution of the Commission.
And I formally requested that in light of that, that was grounds to reopen the investigation, I said at the time that a thorough investigation would reach the same conclusion, that Oswald was a lone gunman. I do think that there were possible questions as to what Oswald's motive was, and one of the great ironies to me is that Oswald, a professed Marxist, an admirer of Cuba, who shortly before the assassination, within a few months, learned through the media that Castro had made a speech saying that if these attacks against him occurred in substance, that they could expect retaliation against American leaders, that the House Assassination Committee would then say, well, look, we've investigated it, and we don't think that there was any retaliatory action on the part of pro-Castro people. We don't think that there was any retaliatory action or any action by pro-Castro, by anti-Castro groups, although individuals might have taken
You have 30 seconds to comment on that.
Okay, mm-hmm. The book as well as the report considers a variety of theories, including Khrushchev did it and Castro did it, and the evidence is substantial to believe that either did it. I do not. It's only the final scenario of the mob did it that I'm persuaded by.
Thank you very much, Professor Blakey. Thank you very much, Mr. Belin. Professor Blakey is the author of The Plot to Kill the President. Thank you, Mr. Mark Green. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Funding for this program was provided by this station, by other public television stations, and by the following. For a printed bound transcript of this program, send $2 to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina 29250. Indicate the subject of the program and please allow 3 weeks for delivery. This program was produced by SECA, which is solely responsible for its content. ¶¶